So thanks, Michael, thanks, Leonard, thanks also to the organizers for inviting me to give this talk. As Leonard said, his talk and my talk belong together. It's a common project where we use two different approaches. Therefore, we decided to split it. Leonard told you about the continuum approach to studying the 2+1 dimensional cross-Neveu model. And I'll talk about our lattice field theory approach. So the physics questions are exactly the same, but the techniques are different. I think I said already it's in collaboration with Michael Buballa, and in particular concerning this part of the talk with Mark Winsel, I highlighted his name because what you will see in the next minutes is essentially his master's thesis he did at the University of Frankfurt. Leonard motivated already what we are doing, very briefly what we are interested with our lattice field theory studies is to further explore and understand whether inhomogeneous phases exist in 2+1 dimensions. You already saw in the first part that probably they don't when you remove the regulator, but what happens at a finite regulator, is there some kind of universal behavior, depends it on the regularization scheme, etc. Of course, we would also like to see the corresponding phase diagram. And I would say most importantly, lattice field theory is an extremely powerful method. So you don't need to make a specific ansatz or just some kind of stability analysis. You can really minimize the effective action. So for example, you can also see what is the shape of the inhomogeneous condensate in an inhomogeneous phase. I mostly speak about point 2 and 4. I'll talk about the lattice discretization so that you understand what kind of regulator and discretization we are using, and then about numerical results. This is a backup slide which defines the model. Leonard did this already. In case you have questions, we can come back to this slide. But let's start immediately with a lattice discretization of the 2+1 dimensional cross-Neveu model. I think even if you're not a person doing numerics, it's clear that when you do numerics, you need a finite number of degrees of freedom. Otherwise, your computer can't handle it. So typically, you need a finite volume and some kind of discretization. And probably the most common discretization is lattice field theory, but there are also other possibilities. For example, you can expand the field in some kind of basis, for example, plane waves or piecewise polynomial functions. I'm telling you that because we are not doing a complete lattice discretization of the action. We treat the time direction in a different way. We assume the condensate to be time independent. Therefore, the time direction is rather trivial to solve analytically. The eigenfunctions of the Dirac operator, the T part, can be solved. They are just plain waves. So it makes no sense to do an expensive and complicated numerical method for something you can immediately do analytically. But in X and Y direction, as you can see here, the condensate can take any shape, any function. And then, of course, we need a numerical method like lattice field theory. And here we do a complete lattice discretization in these two dimensions. Even so, in case you're not a lattice expert, probably you heard that there are a couple of different ways to discretize, in particular fermions, and they are all coming with certain problems. What we are doing here is we are using naive fermions. Naive fermions are not very commonly used because they have the fermion doubling problem, which means you get a factor of 2 in the number of layers described by your field for every dimension. But in our case, we are doing a mean field or large N study. So it is not really a problem because 2 times infinity, equal infinity, in the context of number of flavors. And the advantages of the naive fermions is that chiral symmetry is intact. This is not always the case. For example, Wilson fermions are common, but they break chiral symmetry. And they are also rather cheap to evaluate, at least in comparison to typical chiral formulations of lattice fermions like overlap. One further technical remark, this is more intended to the lattice people here. You need to be very careful when you discretize some kind of theory with naive fermions. The reason is that naive fermion field, which I call chi here, the blue fields, represents four fermion flavors because of the doubling problem. And the relation between the ordinary fermionic fields psi and the naive fields chi is non-trivial. The free action looks identical, and so it's a bit deceptive. But when you are, for example, doing the Gross-Neveu model, you have also four Fermi interaction term. Here it's already replaced by a scalar field sigma and by a chi bar chi field. You need some additional function, which we call here W2, and this function has to have certain properties. If you don't put it there, then you discretize it in a straightforward way, you get a completely wrong action, different interaction terms which are not going away in the continuum limit or anything. So you really need to pay attention to this. I think I have also references here. It was mentioned first in a very old paper, but not solved in a constructive way. And recently we looked at it in the project Andreas Wipf discussed 30 minutes ago. I think we don't need to speak about this further. It's not a lattice conference. Only thing you should keep in mind, we have some degrees of freedom here, what kind of function W2 to use. In a certain sense, you need to cut out the high momenta, and we are using two different discretizations. With one discretization, we cut it out smoothly with a cosinus function, and the other discretization, we use a sharp step function. We call it in the following W prime and W prime prime. So two different lattice regularizations or discretizations. Scale setting. Andreas in his talk has already said it. We express everything in terms of sigma zero, the condensate at T equals zero and mu equals zero. And as usual, in lattice field theory, you can adjust the lattice spacing by the coupling constant. Now let's come to results. Here, it's a very simple thing. We restricted the condensate to a constant, so studied a homogeneous condensate. This was studied already before, I think, the first time by Konstantin Klimenko many years ago, also later by other people. So it's more a check of our method and implementation. So the blue lines are the known results. Red dots are coarse lattice spacing. Purple dots are fine lattice spacing. I think the plot is quite convincing that it seems to work. Now let's turn towards inhomogeneous condensates and phases. The next thing we did is a stability analysis. This is very similar to what Lena told you in the continuum approach. We go to the homogeneous minimum, and then we allow arbitrary perturbations, inhomogeneous perturbations, and we check whether there's any direction in this space which lowers the effective action. And the answer depends on the discretization. For W prime, the answer is no. The phase diagram is identical to the homogeneous one. For W prime prime, the answer is yes, but the region of instability, which is definitely an inhomogeneous phase or part of an inhomogeneous phase, strongly depends on the lattice spacing, and it seems to vanish in the continuum limit. This is what you see here for coarse lattice spacing. This is a large inhomogeneous region, and then at finer lattice spacing, it becomes smaller. Yeah, this context, I would also like to mention this paper here. I think here it was first realized that for some discretization, it probably depends on the lattice spacing and goes away if the lattice spacing is sent to zero. Now let's turn towards full minimizations. We start very simple with a particular ansatz, a cosinus-like ansatz for the condensate. We are doing this to further understand why two actually very similar discretizations give such a different results concerning inhomogeneous phases. And what you see here is a plot of the effective action as a function of alpha. Alpha is the amplitude of this cosinus ansatz. And this is done somewhere in the instability region, where at least for one discretization, you get an inhomogeneous phase. And we consider different lattice spacings, red coarse, pink intermediate, green fine. And what you see is one discretization, the circles, the upper curves, the effective action goes immediately upwards. So no inhomogeneous phase. The other discretization goes downwards and has a minimum at non-vanishing alpha. So this is the reason why one discretization gives an inhomogeneous phase, the other one not. Naja, and when you decrease the lattice spacing, it's also nice to see that the two effective actions come closer together. And yeah, of course we cannot simulate or compute lattice spacing zero, but it seems they converge to the same action. So it's confirmations that we seem to do everything all right, but also interesting in my opinion, because you can see that the discretization has a drastic effect on the effective action and therefore on the on an inhomogeneous phase. Now we are doing now a minimization where we are not allowing every possible modulation of the condensate. This is very challenging computationally, but we are allowing arbitrary modulations in one spatial direction. So sigma can be an arbitrary function of one of the spatial coordinates. And yeah, we start with the region of instability. So here you see the phase diagram. We are now somewhere here in this triangular region. And for smaller mu, we are getting after minimization this result for the condensate, for larger mu that result. And naja, what you can see, smaller mu means larger wavelengths and amplitude and a more kink-like shape. When you look closely, it differs from a cosinus, which is plotted as a line. And this is qualitatively very similar as in 1+1 dimensions, as we know analytically from Thies and collaborators. Good, then we moved towards a homogeneously broken region to check whether maybe after full minimization, the inhomogeneous region increases, or whether there's a new region of inhomogeneous condensate. But it doesn't seem to be the case. The global minimum is always sigma equal constant, but we find local minima, and this local minima, the condensate looks like that, extremely close to a kink anti-kink now. Interesting observation, by the way, is that the local and global minima become closer and closer in the value of the effective action when you go towards t equals zero. And this was already guessed or observed in a certain sense by Konrad Uhrlich many years ago. He did an analytical study at t equals zero with a specific ansatz based on Jacobi elliptic functions. So his results and our lattice results seem to agree, even so we can of course not compute exactly at t equals zero. So finally, we also checked the homogeneously, the symmetric region here, and try to find anything interesting, but there is nothing. The global minimum is just sigma equals zero. So in summary, for the discretization W prime, there's no inhomogeneous phase. For W prime prime, there's an inhomogeneous phase at finite lattice spacing, which coincides with the instability region from the stability analysis, but in the continuum limit, it goes away, and there's only a symmetric and a homogeneously broken phase. Yeah, the only thing left to do in this project, in my opinion, is to extend the minimization to two-dimensional modulations. This is computationally quite demanding, therefore we didn't do it, but we are in the process of improving our algorithms. And then this goes more into the discussion sessions. We are thinking what kind of models to study next, what is most promising with respect to finding perhaps inhomogeneous phases, or also to make some contact to QCD, what kind of models seem to be most realistic. I think we discuss it anyway later. Yeah, so thank you very much.
Thank you, and also Leonard, so both of the speakers. Are there questions to this talk? Okay, I see one by Gerge, I saw just. Right. Now it went away.
Right. I have a question to Mark. Actually, okay. Two short questions. The first is on the lattice, usually we can only calculate derivatives of the effective action. So how do you calculate the effective action itself? And the second, when you said that you're doing lattice simulations with the condensate constraint to homogeneous or constraint to only depend on one variable, how do you do this constraint in practice?
So the answer to the first is simple. In principle, you can, of course, compute the full action on the lattice. It just is expensive, and this is what we are doing. We are computing the full determinant.
But that's the action, right? But the effective action is much more than that, right?
The effective action is the effective action. I think I have it on my slides. The effective action is a rather trivial thing. Here you have it, rather trivial thing from a bosonic field. And then the determinant. And the determinant, we just calculate a large matrix, but it's still fine. It's only two space dimensions. The time direction, as I said, can be solved analytically. And then you have a large matrix, and you can compute the determinant of the matrix via brute force. And of course, in QCD, in 3+1, this is probably not in practice anymore feasible, but here it's possible, and we fully calculate the determinant.
And the sigma integral, there is a sigma integral to be done. This is Z. I would call the effective action log Z.
Maybe there's a misunderstanding. This is not a simulation. This is a numerical approach, minimization. Mm-hmm. Sorry.
Now I mean, Andreas' comment is right, but I didn't get the last point, Gerge.
Let's get back to this in the discussion session. Can you let me know about the
constraint? What was the other thing you asked? Remind me,
how do you do the constraint? You said that you had a slide where you had just homogeneous fields or just sigma dependent on x1. How do you implement this in practice?
For example, here you're seeing a very general expression. You can, no, it's not true. It's still in the fermionic fields, I go back, sorry. You have the lattice expression of this effective action, and there you have your lattice variables for sigma, and either you allow any possible combination of sigma, or for example, when you restrict it to a constant, you set every lattice side to the same constant, and your effective action depends on only one variable. Or when you are taking the cosinus ansatz, you you put a cosinus on all your lattice sides and allow only a global factor for all your lattice sides, which is a cosinus amplitude, or for example, the one-dimensional modulations, and the value of all lattice sides, for example, in y direction, must be the same, but in x direction.
Now I get it. Then it goes back to the same question.
Exactly.
First question. Let's discuss this in the discussion session then.
Okay, I see another question by Julian Lenz. Do you still want to ask a question, Julian?
Julian is wait. May I ask?
Okay. His mic does not work. So I mean Julian's.
I see. Okay, yeah. He just checked. Okay. Yeah, maybe then you may ask a question.
Okay. In this four fermion theory, the qualitative results are expected because we suppose or are sure that four fermion theory is effective theory. It depends on cutoff. For higher energies, this theory might be trivial, but as an effective theory, it might work. Here in model and in model consideration are numerically proved this qualitative result, because even existence or not of inhomogeneous condensates depends on the cutoff. For local limit, when the cutoff is high, we have not condensates. But as an effective theory, when we have reliable cutoff, we may have them. It's expected from the realistic model point of view and from all experience. So I agree that everything is expected, and it is useful for the realistic models, this experience.
Okay. That's all. So it's just a comment as far as I understand, yeah?
I think so, yes. Okay, then maybe thank you both of you again.